A time to praise Allah, and seek His compassion. No doubt you know how short is your life. For Islam's cause you should forever strive. No doubt you know how short is your life. For Islam's cause you should forever strive.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the continuation of our series on how to be proactive in Islam with Dr. Haytham Al-Haddad, Director of the Muslim Research and Development Foundation. Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh Haytham.
Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Shaykh, we talked in the previous episodes about the definition of being proactive, the significance, the importance, and you told us about examples from the Holy Quran where Allah encourages us to be proactive, and also we started talking about examples from Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him's life, and that of his companions' life about proactivity in Islam.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We said that the Ummah of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم should be the best of nations. And in order for the Ummah of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم to be the best of nations, the individuals of that Ummah should be the best of individuals. Now, those individuals have to be inspired by their leaders, by their imams, by their scholars, by the other effective people, the other influential people. And we see that, subhanAllah, very clear in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, and he was even inspiring the young children. The young children, from a very young age, they used to be proactive people. We mentioned quickly the story of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Let me mention the story of Ali ibn Abi Talib. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Mecca, very few people followed him in the beginning. Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha was the first one to accept Islam, and his cousin Ali ibn Abi Talib. Ali ibn Abi Talib at that time, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated to Medina, Ali ibn Abi Talib was about 17, 18, according to some riwayat, because Ali ibn Abi Talib died on the year of 40 for Hijrah, and his age at that time was 57, 58. Okay. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated, he was about 17. So during the Meccan period, Ali ibn Abi Talib was a very young boy. One time, Ali ibn Abi Talib was the second person to accept Islam after Khadija, or he was the first person to accept Islam. Some scholars said even he was the first person to accept Islam. Anyway, among females, Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, among males, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And even Al-Abbas, one time, he then narrated this story. He said, I saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, I saw Muhammad coming towards the Kaaba, and then followed by a young boy, and then followed by a woman. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stopped in front of the Kaaba, next to him the young boy, and behind him Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, and he said, I don't know of any three people who follow that religion except those three people. The young boy was Ali ibn Abi Talib, and the Prophet and Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anhum was behind them. So Ali ibn Abi Talib, look at him. He was a young boy. One time in Mecca, he was walking in the streets of Mecca, and he saw a person looking for something. The intelligence of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu guided him that this person is looking for something. For sure, this person, first of all, he is a stranger. And the way he is behaving at that time, it means that he was looking for something. So Ali ibn Abi Talib approached him. See, this is proactivity. Look at our young children now, 12, 13, or even 10, if we go for maybe another riwayah, 10 years of age, or 12, or 13, or even 15, now the teenagers. How do they behave? What kind of things that they are thinking about?
I'll tell you, Sheikh, I think our young children are more proactive than the adolescents.
Than?
The adolescents, than us.
Maybe they are proactive in certain issues, but they are not concerned about important issues. This is the case. Maybe they are proactive in finding the latest in terms of mobile phones, latest in terms of internet, latest in terms of the singers, football, soccer, and these things. But no, we want them to be proactive in matters that are related to their ummah.
It's our fault, isn't it? Because
exactly. That's why we said the whole society should inspire everyone, including their young children, to be proactive people. We should encourage them. So Ali ibn Abi Talib looked at that person and he said, it seems that you are a stranger. Are you looking for something? Now that stranger is afraid of Ali. He doesn't know him. And that stranger was Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, he heard about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he was in Ghifar. He was away from Mecca. And he sent his brother. And he said, go, let us see who is that person. We heard that he is a magician and he brought some words that are not similar to poem, but some strange things. Go and find out. So his brother went to Mecca to find out about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he just, this is subhanallah, one point even. His brother, the brother of Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, he heard that they said bad things about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He did not investigate. And this is something, a very important quality. Sometimes we hear news and we just stop at that news and we just accept it. We don't investigate further, especially in things that might be beneficial for us or things that might be harmful for us. So he left to Abu Dharr, his brother, and he said, wallah, the people said bad things about him. Abu Dharr told him, "Ma sana'ta shay'an, you didn't do anything. I sent you so you can investigate and find out about the reality of this person." So he said, "I will go myself." So Abu Dharr, he left to Mecca to investigate and to find out. So Abu Dharr, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he doesn't know Ali ibn Abi Talib, and this boy is coming and asking him, "What do you want?" He said, "I want something." Then he said, "Okay, let me, if I can, of a help for you, if you want to stay with me, look at this." So he encouraged him even to stay with him. And in the second day, everyone went for his own business. The second day, Ali ibn Abi Talib noticed that Abu Dharr is doing the same thing. And for sure, this person is looking for something. And he looked at him. And he found that this person is a sincere person. Definitely, he is looking for something good. So he said, "Now you need to let me know. Tell me, what are you looking for?" He said, "I heard about that person who claims that he is a prophet. And he reads something that is strange, that is not like the known poem that we know." He said, "Okay, I will guide you to that person. But be careful, because the people of Mecca, if they know about this, they might harm you." So he said to him, "Follow me." So now Ali ibn Abi Talib, the young boy, invented this. He said, "You need to follow me. And if I find something very suspicious, then I will act as if I am urinating. So you will be careful that, oh, there is something suspicious. So you hide or you go away." So then Abu Bakr,
by a
very young boy. And look at that environment. Muslims were very few in number. The people of Mecca, they were about to attack them at any point. They want to take any chance. So Abu Dharr left behind Ali ibn Abi Talib. And until he took him to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, and as a result of this, Abu Dharr accepted Islam, and as a result of this, the people of Abu Dharr were inspired by Abu Dharr, and many of them accepted Islam because of Abu Dharr. Now, who took the reward of this? The initiative of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Ali ibn Abi Talib took the reward because of his initiative.
And Abu Dharr took on behalf of his people.
Exactly. This is when we encourage the whole society to be proactive people.
Abu Dharr was proactive as well.
Exactly.
Because he wanted to investigate.
Exactly.
Like the boy you told, the story of the boy and the king.
And that's why if maybe this episode is seen or watched by non-Muslims, let me give you the other story about a non-Muslim who investigated, and because of this, he was guided to Islam. Again, from the story of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why we encourage non-Muslims just to investigate. Maybe check. Maybe Islam is true. Don't take my word that Islam is true, that the Quran is true, that Muhammad. the one who lived 1400 years ago, he was a genuine prophet and he was the final prophet. Don't take my word. You go and investigate. Read the Quran, take a copy of the Quran and read it. One of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ before he accepted Islam, Al-Tufayl ibn Amr al-Dawsi. Al-Tufayl ibn Amr al-Dawsi was a very noble person from day one. From day one. And that's why, subhanAllah, even if there are people watching this, if you are noble people, you will investigate. You will not just let the matter to go away. Al-Tufayl ibn Amr one time, after accepting Islam, he said, Prophet, I have accepted Islam and I used to do good things during the time of Jahiliyyah, during the time of Kufr. Will Allah Jalla wa'ala reward me for that? The Prophet ﷺ told him, tell us some stories. He said, one time I had two big camels, luxurious camels. And they ran away, so I was following them because they are very expensive camels. So I tried to find them. So on the way, on the desert, imagine at that time, on the desert, I found a person. And that person, I had a dialogue with him. I was asking about my camels. And during that discussion, his wife told him that I gave birth. So that man, at that time, he said, you gave birth. And what is the boy? What is the child? She said to him, a baby girl. You know, at that time, they used to bury, baby girls. So that man...
Before Islam, of course, prohibited
Islam, that. Before Islam. So that person, he said to her, bring her to me. And he took her, he wanted to bury her. So Al-Tufayl ibn Amr, he said, listen, I found my two camels. And these are two other camels. Would you sell this young daughter and her life for these camels? He looked, he said, yeah, why not? Take her and I'll take the camels in exchange of that. And he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Al-Tufayl ibn Amr, he said, I saved more than 300
subhanallah
or 300 baby girls
Allah.
From being buried alive, as the kuffar used to do that. So Al-Tufayl ibn Amr, he was a noble person from Jahiliyyah, from the time before Islam.
And there is a hadith, isn't there, that the best of you that was before Islam will be the best after being Muslim?
Exactly. And we can see this clearly in the story of Al-Tufayl ibn Amr. And again, of course, the story of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Al-Tufayl ibn al-Amr, he heard about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was from Dawes. Dawes is like the south of Mecca. Al-Tufayl ibn Amr, he said, let me go and investigate. Or in one riwayat, he went to Mecca.
Right. We'll have to put it here. Okay. And dear viewers, certainly you have to stay with us. I'm personally eager to know, and you must be as well, to know the rest of the story here with Sheikh Haytham al-Haddad, Director of the Muslim Research and Development Foundation, talking about being proactive in Islam. Stay with us. We'll be back in a very short time.
You must have time to admire God's creation.
Back to the Prophet. Join Sheikh Amar in the program Back to the Prophet, wherein he teaches us practical lessons from the Prophet's life and how this can help us to overcome our challenges in the present.
We talk about the life example of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, seeking guidance for ourselves. In the early days after the revelation of the Holy Quran, the Muslims were greatly persecuted, so much so that quite a few Muslims had to leave Arabia and migrate to Africa to live among Ahl Kitab, Christian people who followed the gospel of Christ.
You must have time to admire God's creation.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Once again, before the break, Sheikh Haytham was telling us about the story of Al-Tufayl ibn Amr al-Dawsi.
So, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Al-Tufayl ibn Amr went to Mecca. As we said, he is from Dawes. Dawes is a tribe living south of Mecca or south of the peninsula. So he went to Mecca and he asked the people of Mecca, you know that I am At-Tufayl ibn Awr, I'm one of the dignitaries of Daws. Who is that person? They said, be careful. Be careful. He is a liar. He is a magician. And when you hear his words, you will be influenced. You will be influenced. So be careful and try not to listen to him whatsoever. He said, I put cotton in my ears to avoid listening to him to that level. Then one time he said, am I stupid? He said, I am a point. And I know, I can distinguish what is bad, what is good. So why don't I listen to him and to distinguish whether he says something good, whether he says something bad? And then he took it and he said, let me go and listen. When he listened to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reciting Quran, he accepted Islam immediately.
SubhanAllah.
Then what did he do? And this is, again, I want the people who accept Islam, especially in the West, especially in certain tribes, to listen to this story. Because many of them, they accept Islam and they just stand still. They don't do something. At-Tufayl ibn Amr, he said, oh Prophet, I accepted Islam and I'm going to my people and I want to invite them to Islam. This is the first thing he did. So
there's another leader, another proactive
Leader. Proactivity. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at that time, he did not tell him, go and invite your people to Islam. He took the leadership. Okay. He took the initiative in order to invite his people to Islam. So he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, give me a sign as a miracle or as a proof that I have accepted something noble. So Allah jalla wa ala, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Allah jalla wa ala to give him a sign. So he left. At-Tufayl ibn Amr, he left towards his people, and then all of a sudden he had some light on his face, on his forehead. So he said, oh Allah, if my people see that light on my forehead, they might say that this is something bad. So he asked Allah jalla wa ala to put it on his right. So he put Allah jalla wa ala put it his on his right. And then he went all the way to his people. His father came to him to give him salam after a long journey. He said, father, keep away from me. He said, why, my son? He said, I accepted Islam and Islam is the truth. And you need to accept Islam. His father immediately accepted Islam. Then his wife came to him. And she said, he said to her, keep away from me. He had, you might expect that after a long journey, he might be eager to sit with his wife and to talk to her, blah, blah, blah. But he didn't do that because, see, this is the point. And please, brothers and sisters who accept Islam, think of Islam as what? As Islam is the only way that saves you from hellfire and saves your people. Your dear people, the dearest people to you, if they are really very dear to you, then you have to invite them to Islam to save them from the hellfire.
So to find out the Amr Daws did this because he loves his father.
Exactly.
He loves his wife.
Exactly. And this is my
he
point.
He loves his people.
My point, I was in the Netherlands recently and I was giving a course and there was a person who is on his 50s. And he said, I just accepted Islam recently, in fact, 3 years. And 3 years ago. And I was talking about other things related to management and I was connecting things, attaching things to the Akhirah and saving the person's life in the Akhirah from the hellfire. He came to me after that and he said, this is another dimension that I haven't heard of, which is the purpose of Islam is to save people from hellfire. We accepted Islam because it is the truth. My wife has been with me for 3 years and I speak to her slowly, softly about Islam, but I was not thinking of this direction. And many non-Muslims, when they accept Islam, they don't think of Islam from this perspective.
In fact, many born Muslims don't think
exactly,
from
exactly. From Islam but from I mean, in particular, the non-Muslims, when they accept Islam, maybe they accept Islam because they found that Islam is the truth. They found that Islam
is the only convincing religion.
Exactly, is the only convincing religion. But they forget something about the Akhirah. The key point about Islam is to save people from hellfire. And that's why if you really love your wife, your children, your parents, your people, then you have to do your utmost. You have to do whatever you can in order to invite them to Islam. So At-Tufayl ibn Amr said to his wife, keep away from me. You have to accept Islam because Islam is the truth and it is the only way to be saved from hellfire. She accepted Islam. Some other people accepted Islam. He was not very convinced. He went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, some of my people accepted Islam. I want all of them to accept Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allahumma hdi dawsa. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua for them. And At-Tufayl ibn Amr went back to his people. He did not lose the hope. And all of them accepted Islam. He said, we came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina, 70 houses of the people of Daws accepted Islam.
Subhanallah.
See, the noble person, it will be reflected. His nobility will be reflected in all of his activities, in anything related to his activities. And this is what we want from the Muslim individuals. We need to change our life. It is not befitting for our ummah to be at the last of the rank or at the rear of the whole tail of all nations. We want our ummah to be at the front as Allah Jalla wa Ala wanted us to be.
It's because you said, Sheikh, in earlier episodes, that part of being proactive is, you know, taking the initiative and not being reactionary. But it seems the Muslim world's politicians and most of the society is reactionary and not proactive.
Exactly. And we, inshallah, we will deal with this point because this, we maybe mentioned it quickly, this victim mentality. Okay? This victim mentality is a very dangerous mentality. We have to think proactively, is the if the word in English correct. Proactively. We have to think from that perspective rather than thinking in a very reactionary way or thinking in this victim mentality or with this victim mentality. At-Tufayl ibn Amr, for example, as we are mentioning At-Tufayl ibn Amr, it just came to my mind. He said, after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam conquered Mecca or opened Mecca, he said, I came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and I said to him, there is a sanam, an idol, Dhul Kifl. Why don't you send me to that sanam, that idol, so I destroy it? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, once he opened Mecca, he started to destroy the asnam, the idols. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent him. This is, he could have said, okay, easily someone else. But he is taking initiative whenever he finds any opportunity to serve al-Islam, to serve Muslims, what in another way to secure a better position for him in the Akhirah, he will do it.
There's a similarity between his story and that of Abu Dharr, right? Also Abu Dharr.
Exactly.
That you talked about in the beginning of the episode.
And he went to his people as well. Islam. Another story. I don't know whether we have time.
I'm not really sure. But okay. Please go ahead.
Let us take maybe a totally different story. Na'im ibn Mas'ud. Na'im ibn Mas'ud, during the Battle of Al-Ahzab. During the Battle of Al-Ahzab, the Jews who were living around Medina, they were living around Medina, and the people of Quraysh, at that time, they were disbelievers.
Right, they united together.
They united together against Muslims. So the Muslims were in a very difficult situation because the Jews are living very close to Medina. In fact, many of them were living inside Medina. And the people of Quraysh are attacking Medina. And they gathered a big army.
We have 3 minutes exactly.
So, the story goes like this. Na'im ibn Mas'ud, he said, during that time, Allah Jalla wa Ala inspired me to accept Islam. So, I believed in
Islam. He was from Quraysh.
He was from the people of Medina.
Okay.
But he used to have good relationship with Quraysh
and the
Jews at that time.
Okay.
He used to have that good relationship.
Okay.
So he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, I accepted Islam. Not full stop. He said, can I do something for you? See, from day one. From day one. Why?
And he played an important intelligence role.
Exactly. Right. Because he wants to maximize what he wants to get in Jannah. So the Prophet said, خَذِّلْ عَنَّا مَا اسْتَطَعْتَ, means keep them away or do something to help us as much as you can. So the story goes on, and he went to the people of Quraysh and he told them, do you know that the Jews, they broke the treaty between you and them, and they will turn against you because they said that they are living in Medina. They are living in Medina, and they said that if Muhammad won the battle against them, Muhammad will turn against them. So they said, is that true? In the meantime, he went to who? To the Jews. And he told them, listen, Quraysh, they broke the treaty. Because they said, if Muhammad won, we are not the people of that land, so Muhammad will take revenge. So let us just leave. So they said, is that true? So
30 seconds, Sheikh.
Sorry. 30 seconds, we cannot continue the story. So maybe we can continue the story, inshallah,
in another episode, inshallah. Sheikh Haitham Al-Haddad, Director of the Muslim Research and Development Foundation, a UK-based organization aimed at developing leaders for the Muslim world in the West. Thank you very much for talking us through being proactive in Islam. Dear viewers, we'll be waiting for you in the upcoming episode with Dr. Haitham Al-Haddad and more stories from the Prophet's life and from his companion's life about being proactive in Islam, how to serve our lives and our religion. Assalamu alaikum.
You must have time to admire God's creation. A time to praise, to praise Allah, and seek His compassion. No doubt you know how short is your life, for Islam's cause you should forever strive. No doubt you know how short is your life, for Islam's cause you should forever strive. You must have time. Admire God's creation, a time to praise Allah.